Good morning, everyone. If you could kind of start gathering in here and take your seats.
Hello.
Well, if we start singing, they'll get the idea.
You think? Okay. All right. Well.
Now Bonnie's talking.
Well, welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living in the heart of Las Cruces. And it's always such a pleasure and a privilege to be in this sacred place with all you sacred people. So we're going to get started. Oh, I'm Sarah Benson, and this is Doug Benson, and that's Kate Crady. And so we're going to start with a couple of songs. If you would like to stand, I invite you to. And yeah, let's do it.
You are sacred love. Sacred love is all that you are. You are sacred love, God. Sacred love is all that you are. You are sacred love. Sacred love is all that you are. You are sacred love, God. Sacred love is all that you are. Show the way, God, show the way. I want to live in such a state of grace. Lead the way, God, lead the way. I want to live in such a holy place. Such a holy place. You are blessed peace. Blessed peace is all that you are. You are blessed peace, God, blessed peace is all that you are. You are deepest joy is all that you are. You are deepest joy, God, deepest joy is all that you are. Show the way, God, show the way. I want to live in such a state of grace. Lead the way, God, lead the way. I want to live in such a holy place. Such a holy place. You are sacred love. Sacred love is all that you are. You are sacred love, God. Sacred love is all that you are.
Sacred love
is all that you are. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How deeply you're to my soul.
Good morning. And we can take a moment to get over that song. I'm Judy Hunt, your practitioner today. Very proud to be that. Welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living in the heart of Las Cruces, where our vision is a world in loving partnership for the good of all. And how are you hearing in the back there? Is good? Thank you. Good. Welcome to anyone visiting for the first time. We have visitor packets at each door, and they come with a gift certificate to the bookstore and an opportunity to sign up on our email list. That's sure how I keep track of everything that goes on here with that email I get every week. Thanks to all who have signed up to help and set up and take down the Southern New Mexico Pride Festival. That's being held the first weekend in October. There's room for more volunteers. Carrie Porter is organizing that. She's in the back there. So see her. If you have a little chunk of time on that weekend, you could dedicate to us and gay pride in this wonderful community. Everyone up, we got a potluck, ha-ha, food, free food after church, so you'll want to stay for that. We finally can socialize. I also noticed there are questions on the table, so if you're having trouble mixing with maybe people you don't know so well, you can answer the questions and see all the things you have in common and all the things you don't. All are welcome here. Our next yard sale, keep this target, October 28. You need to hold on to your stuff till October 9, but it's never too early to start sorting through those closets, the garage, all those places. I just stick stuff, and it's time to look at it now. So do that, and bring your wonderful things, and make money for the center. Practitioner Bob Greer was not here the Sunday the practitioners got celebrated and loved, which was wonderful. So we would like to invite Bob up, give him his gift, and invite him to say a few words about how he loves out loud here at the center.
Surprise!
I didn't know there would be gifts.
Yes, there's a gift. Thank you so much.
Good morning. What a surprise. She said I was going to, I thought not being here, I'd gotten out of that, but my plan was perfect. I never started out to be a practitioner. I did what many of us do. I'd been searching for some understanding of spirituality. I didn't understand in the beginning the difference between religion and spirituality. To me, they were the same. And then slowly but surely, I started seeking and tried a lot of different things. And I finally, after a divorce and several other upheavals in my life, I ended up at a place called Seaside Center in Encinitas, which is a beautiful spot if you ever get a chance to go there. And I started. Well, number one, the first time I walked into a center, I felt at home, you know, and I loved the vibe and the people, and, you know, they weren't trying to sell me anything or hit me over the head or tell me I'm going to hell, none of that, you know, and I started taking classes because I was curious about this philosophy and this teaching, and I just kept taking the classes, and then eventually one day the senior minister came up and says, you know, you got all your prerequisites out of the way to be a practitioner. And I'm like, okay. And then the next thing you know, I started doing it, and after 2 years, in 2009, I became a practitioner. And from the outside, it looks like, oh, a practitioner does all this noble work, and they pray for people, but the reality is, for this guy, I need to stay in this teaching. I need to stay immersed in it. I need to be reminded. I need to work it on a daily basis because I'll wander. You know, my brain will get hung up on that outside world there, and I need to be connected at all times. Mm-hmm. If I'm able to be of service in some way as a practitioner, great. I love doing what I do here. It's a little stressful at times, but I still love it. And You know, it's been a very, very, very fulfilling path for me, and I encourage anybody to start taking classes if you haven't started doing it already. I'm also a person in 12-step recovery, drugs and alcohol, and I've always found that this philosophy and that understanding, they mesh very well. So if you're familiar with that, I think you'll agree with me. Anyway, it's great. Thank you for this opportunity, and I love you all. Thank you.
Beautifully put. Here at the Center for Spiritual Living and all of the centers for spiritual living throughout the world, we believe in the power of prayer. Our particular prayer is called affirmative prayer or treatment, but anyone who prays is doing it right. So we have prayer requests on the back of each chair. If there's someone in your life or you that needs extra prayer, we have a wonderful group of ministers and practitioners from the four New Thought communities here in Las Cruces, and we meet weekly and pray with you for those concerns. So fill that out, and also let us know how Spirit's working in your life, your answered prayer, with the gratitude cards. Those are always fun to get, and we really celebrate those. And Bob and I are here after service if there's anything you'd like a quick prayer with today. So you want prayer, we got it. Now it's time for song, silence, and prayer. Just relax and feel the Spirit moving in this room. It's not magical, it is present. Spirit moving between these loving, connected beings. Spirit that is our joy, our peace, our strength, the harmony, the divine guidance we have at every moment, the prosperity and abundance. All of this is Spirit in action in our lives. So breathe in breathe in that flow of spirit that enriches and brightens every moment with light, love, and presence. So grateful to be here in all of this abundant light, love, and presence. I am so blessed, and I hope you're feeling that too. And so it is. Our reading today is from the Science of Mind textbook by Ernest Holmes, and it's in the far back where he's talking about, he's interpreting the Bible stuff. It's some of my favorite parts because it can bring that Bible you learned when you were eight into your present life where it functions and it makes more sense. The two great commandments are to love God and our brother man. On these hang all the law and the prophets. Love is a complete unity with life. And we cannot enter this state unless we are in unity with all that lives. For all life is one. To love God alone is not enough, for this would exclude our fellow man. To love our fellow man alone is not sufficient, for this would be too limited a concept of God. When we realize that God and man are one and not two, we shall love both. We shall love man as an expression of God and God as the life principle in all. From this teaching, we are not to suppose that we are to love that in each other, which does not savor of right. We are to love the right alone. We are to look for God in each other and love this God, forgetting all else. But would this compel us to accept from people that which is not good? Of course not. It is not necessary for one to make a doormat of himself in proving that God is love, for this would be like suffering for righteousness' sake, which is always a mistake. I love when Ernest is direct. We should be wise in the ways of the world, as well as imbued with divine wisdom. We are not to mistake a counterfeit for the real, nor accept every man's doctrine, lest we disagree. The truth is positive, but non-combative. It is sure of itself, but never argumentative. It loves sincerity and abhors deceit. Above all else, the truth is wise. It represents the all-seeing eye from which nothing can be hidden. The student of truth will receive all that comes in the name of the Lord, that is, all that is of the truth. All else will fall by its own weight. And now, special music with a whole crew.
We're doing pop songs today, and I'm sure you guys know them, so join in. The first one is Let Your Love Flow. One, two, three, four.
There's a reason for the sunshine sky, there's a reason why I'm feeling so high. Must be the season when that love light shines all around you.
So let that feeling grab you deep inside and send you reeling where your love can hide, and then go stealing through the summer nights with your lover.
Let your love flow like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams, and let your love show. And you know what I mean, it's the season. Let your love fly like a bird on the wing and let your love bind you to all living things and let your love shine. And you know what I mean, that's the reason.
There's a reason for the warm, sweet nights. There's a reason for the candlelight. Must be the season when there's love right shine all around you.
So let the wonder take you into space and let you under its loving embrace. Feel the thunder as it warms your face. You can't hold it back.
Just let your love flow like a mountain stream and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams and let your love show. And you know what I mean, it's the season. And let your love fly like a bird on the wing and let your love bind you to all living things and let your love shine. And you know what I mean, that's the reason. Just let your love flow like a mountain stream and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams and let your love show. And you know what I mean, it's the season. Let your love fly like a bird on the wing and let your love bind you to all living things and let your love shine. And you know what I mean, that's the reason. And let your love shine. And you know what I mean, that's the reason.
Thanks. Thank you. Perfect song, as usual. I love it. Thank you all. Thanks for being here. Good morning to everyone. I'm Reverend Bonnie, the community spiritual leader here at the center, and I'm glad to see everyone. This place is full today, and we filled it up last night at that Celtic concert as well. It was fabulous. So it's good to be out and about again, isn't it, in the real world? So it's been quite a week, especially in regard to what I would call my calling to ministry, which I see as sort of ministering to people's needs or whatever shows up. And when I say ministry, that means to me loving out loud, which happens to be our topic for this month. Love out loud. And so I find it interesting, I'm starting to get pretty used to it, how the universe provides us with all these opportunities to do exactly what we're contemplating. Whatever we're looking at for the month, whatever we're working on in our life, we're always given the opportunity to put it into practice. And so this week, starting with last Sunday, I had a friend in the hospital who's still there, so spent a lot of time visiting her. And another friend of mine was her power of attorney, so I became sort of the backup support to her, making sure she had food while she's sitting in the ICU, making sure her laundry got done and ready to go because she had a pre-planned trip to leave on Wednesday. So I was sort of the backup support there. And then I had another friend who called and said that she was going to be driving to El Paso. She'd been in an accident in January. She lost the use of her dominant arm and hand. She was going to drive to El Paso with her other good hand by herself. And I said, oh, no, you're not. And it happened to be the day it rained, so you know, I drove her into El Paso. It was a good thing. She needed to fill out paperwork. She, you know, you might want to practice writing with both hands because she has a real hard time now writing with her non-dominant hand. So that was an event that I got to do. I got a call from somebody in our community whose mother passed away, and they wanted me to do a memorial. So we sat down and created that memorial, which will take place Tuesday. And it turns out that the deceased woman was somebody who showed up here a couple Sundays before we closed down for COVID. And then she stayed in touch with this teaching through the internet and discovered Agape and just fell in love with the music and all that they were doing. So the family wanted me to be present to bring into that experience of the memorial this teaching. And then, while I was sitting in the hospital, I got news that some of you might remember Dawn Kempthorne. She was part of our community. She joined us. She spent about 5 to 6 months living in my home, and she passed away. Her daughter contacted me, so we spent time commiserating together over the loss of this beautiful individual who had been in our lives. And then I had another friend contact me, and she and her son needed a place to stay for the next 6 weeks, and it has been a total blessing to me that she showed up with her son and is now sharing my home with me for 6 weeks. So, don't answer my phone. I'm actually leaving Wednesday to go help another friend who's having back surgery. I'm going to be in Seattle with her over next weekend to help her after the surgery. Well, now, why am I telling you all this? Why am I telling you all this? Because to me, that's love moving out loud in my life. Because not only do I get to give, but I receive so much love this week because of these experiences. And I also feel like we've been talking about community. We've been talking about our community. And I don't think this is just what a minister does. This is what we all do for each other. We step up for each other. We're present for each other. We support each other through all kinds of experiences. And I know individuals in this room have experienced that from within this community. And so that's why I thought I would talk about it. And plus, the topic is loving out loud. So I thought, well, I need to speak it out loud. I need to just share what showed up and how love has moved in my life this week, very loud and clear. And so I also know that I've spoken about Valerie Carr before. She wrote the book, See No Stranger. I've shared that with you several times. And she says, love is dangerous business. If you choose to see no stranger, and what she means by that is we know our unity with all people, so no one shows up in our space as a stranger when we choose to see no stranger and remember our unity. She says, when you choose to see no stranger, then you must love people even when they do not love you. You must wonder about them even when they refuse to wonder about you. And when she uses wonder, she's talking about what we've talked about here, getting curious about each other, wondering what makes that person tick, wondering what it is that they're doing in their life, why they're doing it, getting curious. So she's saying we need to wonder about them no matter whether they choose to wonder about us or not. And you must even protect them when they are in harm's way. To me, that is loving out loud. That's how we choose to love when we're part of a community. So I'm going to ask you, how have you loved out loud this week? Anyone have another example of how love has moved in their life out loud? I'll give you a minute.
I cooked for someone.
Ah, she cooked for someone, yes, that needed that and brought a meal to them. Mm-hmm. Beautiful. Anyone else? Yes, Donna. Ah, a neighbor was collecting money, standing on the corner.
Stopped and talked to him and gave him money.
Top. A neighbor, good. Stopped and talked and gave him money. Beautiful. Anyone else? Yes, Kathleen.
Checking in with people who I know are having a hard time.
Right. Checking in with folks when you know they're having a hard time. Sharon. Okay, helping someone figure out their landscape design and did it gratis and gave it to them as a gift. And that's her specialty. That's what she's good at. Wonderful. Yes?
I have
So texting little pictures to cheer them up, you know, to people that she knows that are having challenges in their lives. Great. Why, Thera? Wonderful. She got loved out loud herself. She experienced that by a young man that used his discount card and let her go ahead of him in the grocery store. Yeah, it works both ways, doesn't it? Fabulous. And I know as your mind starts percolating, you'll have new and more ideas of how you've experienced it and how you've shared it. So that's part of what those questions are on the table for you to discuss during the potluck. Share with each other how you've loved out loud in the past, how you're doing that now. There's other questions there related to the talk this morning to help you generate some thought and conversation. Well, years ago, I got to see Greg Bearer speak at the Albuquerque Center for Spiritual Living, and he wrote this book, Real Love, and I've shared from this over the years as well. And when he's talking about real love, he's talking about unconditional love and his interpretation of unconditional love. So I pulled this book out this week because I'm thinking, you know, as we're talking about loving out loud, we're talking about real love, what that looks like, how we love each other unconditionally. And so is that just related to spouses and partners that we need to do this? Oh, no, exactly. Or family? No. So real love applies to how we interact with and love anyone in our life, our community, this community right here, the larger community, people that show up and visit from outside. So I wanted to share with you what he defines as unconditional love or real love. Real love is caring about the happiness of another person without any thought for what we might get for ourselves. When we give real love, we're not disappointed, hurt, or angry, even when people are thoughtless or inconsiderate or give us nothing in return, including gratitude, because our concern is for their happiness, not our own. Real love is unconditional. But he goes on to share what it's like to experience real love. It's real love when other people care about our happiness without any concern for themselves. They're not disappointed or angry when we make foolish mistakes, when we don't do what they want, or even when we inconvenience them personally. And so there's a whole lot in here. I recommend this book, especially if you're looking at this idea of what is unconditional love in your life. What Greg Bearer does is goes around and teaches these workshops. He creates groups to support each other in experiencing real love. Because part of what he's saying is that we have to fill up. We have to be full ourselves before we can love someone else. So near the end of the book, he says, "When our bucket is full to overflowing, loving others becomes effortless. However, there is something about loving other people that's different from pouring water out of a bucket. As you share real love with those around you, you often find at the end of the day or at the conclusion of a single interaction that you'll have more love than you started with, even if the person or people you loved gave you nothing in return. In some miraculous way, your bucket fills up as you empty it. For this reason," he says, "I can't propose strongly enough that the fullest measure of happiness in life comes from sharing our love with others at every opportunity." But then he also talks about, and we know how it feels when we've given and given and given and we feel depleted. So he talks about that as well. And he says, "Sometimes, especially while you're still learning to love, you'll attempt to give more than you have. When that happens, your bucket will empty out." And he has an example in here of what happened when somebody did that. And he said, that's when you need to call someone and get your bucket filled back up. So we often try and get that person who's depleting us to fill us, and that's not going to work. We need to know that we have other people in our lives that can fill our bucket. So who are they? Be aware of them. So if you start to give more than you have, you contact those other people who can fill you up. So you have more to give. He says, giving real love is relatively effortless when compared with the enormous exertion associated with lying, attacking people, acting like a victim, and otherwise manipulating people. In fact, as you're learning how to love people, stress is a sign that you may not be unconditionally loving the people around you and that you may need more real love for yourself. So again, as your bucket gets depleted, you start to feel that stress, you start to want to manipulate, you try and do all these things, and that's a sign that you need to go find someone who can fill you up, some way to fill up your love bucket, so to speak. He says, we have many opportunities to love people around us if we use them. We'll create relationships and bring a happiness into our lives that we simply cannot imagine. The sooner we start, the more loving and happy we'll be. So I really encourage people that are looking at that. He's got some great ideas. He has workbooks specific to parenting and other things like that as well that I looked at way back when. So real love, what does that look like? How do we do that? How do we practice real love or unconditional love? And then this month, we're talking about loving out loud. So I looked at that term out loud. What did that mean? Well, it's sort of different than in silence, right? It's somehow I thought of noise, or somehow something had to be heard. And so I often go back to my roots, which is the Christian scriptures and that teaching. And I thought about 1 Corinthians that said, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and knowledge, and though I have the faith to move mountains and have not love, I have nothing. And I thought about, you know, how do we make noise? When is it loving out loud and when is it just noise? Well, the difference is the love. Real, unconditional love shifts us into a place where we're bringing something positive into the world and it's not just a bunch of noise. We need to have the love there with whatever we do, which took me then to another Christian scripture in Matthew 6, where Jesus taught, when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray in silence. And I thought, so why some things we're told to do in silence and in private, and we're talking about loving out loud, how do these things go together? Because I think I had always thought everything I do needs to be kind of hidden and private. You know, don't look, I don't need to hear, thank you. You know, I kind of went through that. I'll get my reward in heaven someday. Don't look at me right now. You know, I've really had that stance. So this idea of loving out loud is like, whew. You know, so it was not easy to just share with you, oh, this, and this, because it feels like bragging, and that's not the intention. When I think of us loving out loud, we're doing it in a way that we allow it to be seen. We do it because it's real love, and it gets bigger and bolder the more that we experience that. And so I want to keep the focus on love so it doesn't become noise, so it doesn't become what Jesus was talking about, like the people praying on the street corners for attention. So it's a different thing. I think you all are nodding your head, so I think you're getting what I'm talking about. And then I thought about loving out loud and how many people throughout history have had to hide who they love, have had to hide who they are attracted to or want to spend a loving relationship with. And I started thinking about all the way back to Romeo and Juliet. Wasn't that a story about they weren't supposed to be together? And then I thought about how in the 1960s here in the United States, interracial marriages were illegal in 31 states. 1960. It wasn't until 1967 that the US Supreme Court in the Loving versus Virginia case made interracial marriage legal. 1967, we were all alive then. Yeah, okay. And when I looked up the exact dates, I want to note that interracial marriage had been protected internationally by the Universal Declaration of Human Rights since 1948. The US took 19 years to get on board. Yeah. And then we can look at gay marriage or same-sex marriage. The first legal gay marriage was in April of 2001 in the Netherlands. In May of 2004 was the first legal gay marriage in Massachusetts here in the United States. And yet there had been legal cases being brought asking for recognition since the 1940s. So I didn't know that either. It wasn't until June of 2015 that the US Supreme Court legalized same-sex marriage in all 50 states. So my question then was, is loving out loud mean our ability to be loud about who we love, to be okay and to share who we love instead of having to hide it? And we know that marriage is not just about sex. We're talking a loving relationship, a loving, committed relationship where it's finally allowed to take place, where we didn't have to hide. And then I heard last week on NPR that there are still arranged marriages in India and other parts of the world. And what happens sometimes is people want to step out of those and move into a relationship maybe with someone they love versus who's been prearranged for them. And it reminded me of the story of Fiddler on the Roof. I think many of you have probably heard or seen that movie. And that story was partially about arranged or traditional marriages versus marriages that rooted in love, that started because of a love relationship. And so I looked up the words to the song that they've played in there. The husband and wife sing this song to each other when the husband is intrigued by the fact that one of his daughters wants to marry someone she loves instead of who they have arranged for her. And so his question to her, his wife, is, "Do you love me?" And his wife says, "25 years I've washed your clothes, cooked your meals, cleaned your house, given you children, milked the cow. After 25 years, why talk about love?" And he responds from his side, talking about how they felt when they met, how scary it was to spend their first night together after being married, because they didn't know each other, and how his parents had told him they would learn to love each other. And so he asks her again, "Do you love me?" And she said, "25 years I've lived with him, fought with him, starved with him. 25 years my bed was his. If that's not love, what is?" And then the husband says, "So, does that mean you love me?" And she says, "I suppose I do." And that made me start to wonder, can we grow in love? Can we learn to love each other? Whether it's a marriage, whether it's a community, does that mean that we have to have that initial feeling, or can we spend time together, experiencing life together like they did, and eventually say, "Yeah, you know, I love you." Think about all that we experience in this community. Think about all we've experienced together over the years. Think of other people in your lives. Have you been able to grow a love for some people that maybe you didn't start out feeling so cool about right off the bat? Yeah. So to me, real love is something we can develop as well as maybe have that sort of instant feeling about. And again, like I said, not just in marriage, but in any relationship that we have. We can learn within our community. Ernest Holmes, in a chapter where he's talking about friendship, says, "In order to have this friendship enduring, true, really worthwhile, and a thing of beauty, we should cultivate an attitude of friendship toward everybody and everything. The one who has learned to love all people will find plenty of people who will return that love. This is not mere sentiment, and it is more than a religious attitude of mind. All is mind, and as we attract to us what we first become, until we learn to love, we are not sending out love vibrations, and not until we send out those vibrations can we receive love in return." And further in that chapter, he says, "One of the first things to do is to love everybody. If you have not done this, begin to do so at once." Those are his words. "There is always more good than bad in people, and seeing the good tends to bring it forth. Love is the grandest healing and drawing power on earth." And so, listening to Holmes, thinking about that song from Fiddler on the Roof, looking at our community, I think it is possible for us to move from that space of love and develop love. And so again, I was kind of in a Jesus mode this week. I thought more directly and challenging was the teaching attributed to him, again in Matthew, "Love your enemies and bless those who curse you." And further on in Romans, Paul was teaching, "Love must be sincere. Be devoted to one another in love. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." So again, if we really believe we are love expressing in the world, if we really believe we are all one in God, which is love, then we use love as that tool for healing any apparent separations, any of that stuff that goes on between us and others, even those we might perceive as our enemy. And that's not easy. I think that's the practice. That's the part that is challenging. And to me, that's when we're loving out loud. Edwin Gaines, when she teaches about abundance, talks about one of the important ways of bringing more abundance in our life is to do forgiveness. And the way she practices that is each night she'll ask herself, who have I pushed out of my heart today? Who have I pushed away from my heart? And when she thinks who those people might be, she realizes that's who she needs to forgive and bring back into her heart space. So we're talking about unity again, the idea that we are all one, this idea that love can heal, and that behaving lovingly allows that healing to take place, which I would say is loving out loud. So our class that we have right now from whence we came is reading, this is a really cool book. It's not very common. In fact, most of us had to find it online used. It's the Holmes Papers, The Philosophy of Ernest Holmes, Volume 1. So there's some stuff in here. It's often transcribed from his talks. So you get a sense of his personality a little differently than you do from the textbook exactly. But in here he says, we do not arbitrarily say God is love, we believe it. Some great psychologists will say love or perish. They discover love as the greatest healing power. Without love, there is nothing worthwhile. They discover love is the most salutary thing. By and by, so much evidence will be piled up that the thoughtful mind will say, what is back of it must be all love. So he was all about what we know, love and law, but love was the key thing, that is the connection, how it is that we are all one. And he talks about the importance of loving our enemy. So now sometimes, have you not heard it said, you are your own worst enemy? So where do we start with love? Yeah, being sure that we love ourselves. And right after my son passed, I was given this book by Lily Ann called Love Yourself, Life, Your Life Depends on It, Because It Does. And I handed it out to a lot of you, and I still recommend that to those of you who don't have it, because it is so key, and often that is the missing link to our ability to walk this planet in a more happy, more centered way. If we don't love ourselves, our bucket isn't full, we can't love others. And we start filling that bucket by loving ourselves. And part of loving ourselves, like Ernest Holmes said in our reading this morning, is it's not necessary for one to make a doormat of himself in proving that God is love. So there's that balance of knowing that we love ourselves enough that we're not going to let someone walk all over us. We can still love people without letting that happen. So even though Greg Bear says, we want to love without any thought for what we get back. We're not loving to the point where we're depleting ourselves and where we're letting people walk all over us. So it's finding how to stay full and let the overflow go out to everyone around us. And then Thomas Merton said, the beginning of love is to let those we love be perfectly themselves and not to twist them to fit our image. Otherwise, we love only the reflection of ourselves we find in them. Yeah. Read that again. Okay. The beginning of love is to let those we love be perfectly themselves and not to twist them to fit our own image. Otherwise, we love only the reflection of ourselves we find in them. So there's a lot of things to think about, huh? A lot of different ways we can look at what does it mean to love out loud. And so I always like to bring it back to our community and how we love each other right in this room out loud and those who come into this room. And we have a community commitment that we share before our board meetings and that we share during the annual meeting. And one of the things it says in there is if anything unlike love comes up, we'll hold the other in our heart and listen. So that's like Edwin Gaines. We bring them back into our heart And listening is part of what Valerie Carr was talking about, wondering, listening, getting curious about that person in that situation so that we can allow love to do its healing work. So we have a lot of opportunities here to practice unconditional love, to practice how to love out loud with each other, and maybe even fall in love. Who knows what you might experience in these walls. We get to speak our truth and allow love to move in and through us, no matter what it is we're doing, and not just on Sundays. We have a lot of opportunities to work side by side here, to take classes together, to work on projects in this building together, to support each other in our lives, what's going on outside of here together, to greet each other, remembering as we greet people that we don't know, that we know no stranger. Anyone who walks through these doors is already one with us, and we can allow ourselves to love them out loud. We can interact with people who are different from us. One of the things I've learned since I've been here, I heard so many times, oh, it's so wonderful to be in a community with like-minded people. We are not all like-minded people. What I've learned is how to love those that are not like-minded with me. And we can invite in and share the space with people who might think differently than us, who might believe a little differently, might interpret this teaching a little differently, but we can still love. We can still bring love into that relationship. So to me, that's the challenge of this community, and that's what's exciting about this community. And I am also proud to know that we embrace and show love to some people who might not have ever found it anywhere else in their world, in their life. They might not have found it in other spiritual communities where we say, you're welcome here and you can love out loud here. You are okay. Just the way you are. That song this morning, you always pick it. I'm glad I didn't have to speak right after. It always makes me cry. That's why you do it, to make me cry. Thanks, Sarah. Well, it worked on Judy this time. So one of the things that we have in action and movement right now is our community action group. And the last time we got together, we came up with a whole variety of ideas of things that we could do where we could share our love with each other and with our greater community. So I'm going to read you some of the list from that meeting, and I want you to just listen with your heart. And if any of this calls to you, like, ooh, I want to get involved with that, we're looking for you. We want you to step up, create the team that's going to make this reality, because what we're really doing, no matter what one of these activities, is we're learning to love, and learning to love each other out loud. So, some of these ideas were a teen discussion group, maybe an after-school discussion group, neighborhood community groups where they learn who they are in their neighborhood for rides, meals, support, and even gathering for discussions. We have a spiritual circle that meets over Zoom right now, but those spiritual circles could meet out in neighborhoods and in people's homes if you would be interested in doing that. Someone suggested maybe having breakfast for the businesses on the downtown mall so we could get to know our neighbors on the street here that are all part of this community. Collaborating with other New Thought communities beyond our weekly prayer group. That's where we collaborate right now, but other things we might want to do together. And I want to note for you all that next Sunday, Teresa is facilitating a panel with a member of each one of the other New Thought communities will be on that panel sharing with you as she facilitates. I will be, like I said, with my friend in Seattle, but I am excited to see what they have to say, because it's gonna be taped. So be here and see what we're doing as a group together, all the different New Thought centers. Possibly hosting a spiritual or metaphysical fair. We had one here before and it was fabulous, so doing that again. Hosting a New Thought singer or speaker to come in from outside of our community. Tutoring kids after school. Displaying art by children in the schools on our art walls, and hosting the Survivors of Suicide support group. And that's something that several of us have gone to the training for already, and that is supporting those of us who have had someone in our lives die by suicide and creating support groups that go for 8 weeks to help move through that experience. And so we want to be a place that can host a group or two or three, who knows how that will move forward. Having a youth dance that is drug and alcohol free. Possibly another open mic night like the Howling Coyote was. pancake breakfasts on Saturday mornings, of course, our treasure sale that we're getting ready to have, and more. So there's all kinds of activities we can do where working together, we learn to love each other, and we learn to share that love out into the community. And so if you have any other ideas that aren't on that list, we are open to hearing them. We are open to supporting you, to gather around you, the community members that can make that a reality. Whatever vision just pops into your head for how you can love out loud here and take it out into the community. It is time, I believe, for us to speak out and to love out loud. And that made me think of one more biblical passage from Ecclesiastes. I'm sure you've heard the song, a time for this, a time for that. Remember that song that they had? And one of the things it says in that passage is a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate. And in my mind this week, it's a time to speak and it's a time to love, so it's a time to love out loud. Do you agree? Yeah, and so it is. Thank you. Yes, our practitioners are moving into place, so we invite them to move around the room, and I'm just gonna take you through a little meditation today instead of just a prayer. So center in, because I think we often wonder how it is we can do this. How do we love a stranger? How do we love an enemy, a perceived enemy? How do we practice and learn to love? So as you go within, just breathe into your heart space, connect in with your heart space. And just bring to mind someone that's really easy for you to love. Bring into that heart space that person and just let yourself feel the love that you have for them. And it can be yourself as well. Just feel what it's like to feel love. And as that feeling of love grows, see it expand from your heart space all out and around you to totally envelop you. And as it envelops you, feel what it's like to feel loved. Imagine that heart space being a little bucket filling up. Just see what it's like to feel loved and let yourself fill. And now bring to mind somebody maybe you just met or someone you barely know, and see if you can bring them into your heart space with that idea that there is no stranger. And see if you can bring them into that space where you allow yourself to feel love toward them. And now allow your mind to settle on someone who might be a challenge right now. Whether it's a challenge because you perceive them as an enemy or just someone that is difficult to love or that you've had a challenge with. And see if you can't bring them into your heart space. Just bring them in and sit with it. You don't need to say anything to them. They don't need to say anything to you. But just hold them in that space of love. Know that you are safe as you do that right here in this room. And now just see them melting away into love itself, releasing them and blessing them on their way. And just take these words of Ernest Holmes again from the Holmes papers. We shall recognize that effort, that power, that depth of feeling, that glory of creativity, that warmth and color of love, that song that is celestial. We shall know that here and now God itself, goes forth anew into creation through us. We have accepted the gift of life and are now playing with it on the shores of time, where the waters of the infinite wash our feet. Yet all eternity seems in our hearts. We are embraced, held in the soft embrace of that which is pure love and perfect peace. And so it is. Thank you. And thank you, practitioners.
Ready? Okay, we're gonna do Let's Get Together. Jefferson Airplane. So, yeah, please sing along.
It's but a song we sing, and fear's the way we die. You can make the mountains ring, or make the angels cry. Know the dove is on the wing, and you need not know why. Each other, everybody get together, try to love one another right now.
Some will come and some will go, and we shall surely pass.
When the one who left us here returns for us at last. We are but a moment's sunlight fading on the grass. Come on, people now, smile on each other. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now.
If you hear the song I sing, you must understand.
Hold the key to love and fear in your trembling hand. One key unlocks them both, and it's at your command. Come on, people now, smile on each other. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on each other. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Right now, right now.
Thank you. And we know about try. We're not going to try, right? We're going to love out loud. We're going to do it. We're going to love each other right now. Thank you so much. Beautiful. And we're going to give a little love to Michael. He's 83 today. Welcome. We're glad you're here. Deb's always loving us up with food. She brought food to share, but they're going to take him out to his birthday lunch today. So we're just grateful that you all showed up and brought your love with us in the form of food and your presence. Always, yes. That's another form of love, is it not? So thank you again for the music. You guys, that was great. It was so perfect, as usual. And so right now we talk about how it is what you love the center with what you give to the center, and 10% of what comes through goes out as we love our greater community. Mesilla Valley Community of Hope Tents to Rent this month is receiving 10% of all that comes into the center. And that's a little bit about them there. So let's just say our blessing together. Go, Bob. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies
all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God, in me. And as you sing, I am so blessed, I hope you feel it and feel the love that you've received and that you've given out.
I am so blessed, I am so blessed, I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed, I am so blessed, I am so grateful, I am so blessed. I am so blessed, I am so blessed, I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed, I am so blessed, I am so grateful, I am so
I certainly feel blessed, and I know we're going to be even more blessed as we join each other for a meal. Don't forget the practitioners are here to pray for you, with you, after the service, if there's anything you'd like to, or fill out those forms. Drop them in the offering plate as you go out, and we will pray over them this week along with you. And don't forget, you've got questions to share with each other at the table and food. So let's stand and sing our closing song and get ready for more fun in the social hall.
Okay. We're going to do the peace song.
Ah, yay.
Yeah.